The Etruscans were a relatively small group of people, and their culture was very similar, if not identical, to that of the Scythians and Sarmatians. But I have a full episode of the Survivors series devoted to them, not because they played some very special or significant role in the development of our civilization, but because they are a very, very vivid example, along with Genghis Khan, of how our history school books are no better than bedtime stories for children. And indeed, the bedtime stories have a much higher educational intrinsic value, because at least they tell about the times when magicians and giants were walking the earth, and that, unlike the stories that we read in the history books, was something that actually happened. Adriano La Regina is the president of the National Institute of Archaeology of Italy. He says, it is a universally accepted fact nowadays that the Etruscans were the founders of Rome, and their role in forming the full Italian antique culture is enormous. In the beginning, Rome itself had three Etruscan emperors. And yet further, he assures us that nobody knows where the Etruscans came from, and their writing is absolutely unreadable. Then he was asked the following question: why exactly the Etruscan is unreadable? After all, similar looking writings are translated without any problem. What is the problem exactly with the Etruscan? And he says, there is no problem actually reading it. The alphabet and the sounds are completely readable. And they are very similar to the ancient Greek alphabet and few other ancient alphabets. However, the only problem is that we don't know the meaning of the words. That's why we consider this language undecipherable. But is that really true? It was a couple of centuries ago that the Italian professor Sebastiano Ciampi happened to work in the University of Warsaw. And because he was in a Slavic country, he learned a bit of Polish language. Much to his great surprise, even with a very minimal amount of simple Polish language, he started not only reading Etruscan inscriptions, but also understanding the text. On his return in Italy, he was happy to share his discovery with his Italian colleagues. However, they simply refused to even take a look at his work, because they said that the most authoritative and learned German scholars already long ago have established what was the history like, and so this cannot be true, and it cannot be because it cannot be. And he was not alone. Other scholars discovered the same, like Tadeusz Walanski and Alexander Chertkov. This is a comparison table compiled by Walanski of the Etruscan alphabet. In the first column, you see the Etruscan letters, and in the second column, you see the Cyrillic counterparts. Both alphabets bear great resemblance. Here are a few examples. Look at this sample Etruscan inscription that comes first in the mainstream history book on the Etruscans, written by Ulrich Friedrich Coppa. In his book, he loudly assures us that Etruscan is absolutely unreadable forever. He doesn't even discuss this inscription in his full book. This is how you read the inscription.
Стерела Купида ранит минифеи.
Now, I myself don't know any ancient Slavic language. I only know contemporary Slavic languages. And yet I hear in plain speech, without the need of any translation, the way the Etruscans wrote it hundreds of years ago, that the arrows of Cupid will wound or are wounding the nymph. It really sounds to me like some sort of dialect from a remote village area. It doesn't sound like a foreign language at all. Moreover, it fully corresponds to the image, every single word. And here is another one. Львид сигямнит. It is also completely relevant to the image, because there is something like a lion. For sure. And so the Catholic Church became aware that people will easily figure out the stories that they're presenting as history, and that's why the fate of Mr. Volansky was not an easy one. Not only they declared his books as heresy and started hunting down for them and burning them, but they also sentenced him to death. And it was only by the endeavors of a certain emperor that he eventually managed to escape. Instead of actual historic research based on ancient inscriptions, the mainstream historians always quote Theodor Mommsen and others like him. He wrote other correct history of Rome, and it is always said and quoted that it was based on hundreds of old books from all these sources and all that, and he had them at home and he compiled them all, and always the same trick. After he finished his work, all of a sudden all this fire devoured everything, and not even a single one of these books is left now. Please note, though, that not all Etruscan inscriptions can be fully understood. After all, this was a language spoken hundreds of years ago, and it's normal that we don't understand everything. Another point is that all inscriptions that are not Roman are automatically classified as Etruscan in Italy. And since the Etruscans were interracial team, as usual, usual for the groups of survivors that were traveling to different places and spreading the culture. If you remember, a team of Caucasian, African, and Chinese people, and maybe others as well, arrived in America. So these are some Etruscan artifacts clearly showing African presence of black people among the Etruscans. So it is absolutely possible that they were using the Etruscan alphabet to write down their own spoken language that could have been different. Although often on the Etruscan murals we see the typical tall Scandinavian looks blonde survivors, there were other people as well along with them. Again, those were not slaves and servants, as you can see on this mural, he was the boss. Mainstream historians also loudly assure us that nobody has any clue where the Etruscans came from, and yet somebody made a photograph of this old map that was found in the Vatican. Strange that they didn't notice it before. So here we see not only the Etruria in Italy, but also the original Etruria, somewhere in the Thracian-Dacian region, and that is fully consistent with the Etruscan artifacts. Look at their pottery. It is that very same style of Scythian, Sarmatian, ancient Greek, ancient Thracian, ancient Dacian, so many labels for one and the same style. They even called all these different, entirely different civilizations. What a big word! And it was all one single culture. We saw the comparison in the previous episode. Same pottery, same architectural style, same language. Everything is the same. The Scottish scholar Thomas Dempster compiled a meticulous study of the Etruscans, published in a couple of big volumes, compilation of ancient work, showing that it was the Etruscans who gave to the full region of Rome and full Italy technology, medicine, agriculture, and basically all culture and knowledge. Everywhere else on earth, they simply came to educate people. But how did the Etruscans call themselves? The name they used is Resena, that is well accepted even by mainstream historians. Do you remember the quote from Mavro Orbini? Also said that the survivors called themselves Rasenami, which means the scattered ones. And that is why, he continues, various nations derived their names from this word. Another nation that did that is the Russians. It is not a secret that they call themselves Russi. That's how it sounds in their language, and it was formed by and the root of that was Rasenami. For example, in this Etruscan inscription, they talk about Russia using the main, very main word that is historically well known to signify Russia, and that is Russia. And that is, by the way, how the Russian people themselves till nowadays call their country Russia. The land that was founded by the scattered ones. By the way, Etruscans, the very word as it is in English may not sound as close to Russians, but that's only in English. In the Slavic language, it sounds like this, Etruskie. It is very near to Ruskie, almost the same. It doesn't mean that the Etruscans are Russians. It means that both regions, that of Italy and that of Russia, initially received their culture from these scattered ones. Also, please note that since Etruskie and Ruskie is very near in the Slavic language, it probably has been even at the time when the Etruscans were speaking their own language, because it was basically a Slavic language. Of course, as everywhere else on earth, the swastika was their symbol. Some believe it used to depict the shape of our galaxy or the Milky Way or something else from the cosmos. Here is what everybody calls a Roman-style helmet. It's actually Etruscan. Here are the Etruscan sphinxes. The Etruscan laurel wreath. When the official history was being cooked and fabricated, the Etruscans were uncomfortable. They were not supposed to be here. All these inventions and all the knowledge they gave was accredited mistakenly to the Romans. So what to do with them? As usual, throw them in the faraway, unimportant past, centuries before Christ. But in fact, the main book of the Etruscans, although we don't have it in original, we only have it in corrected by the Jesuit monks form, still, even in its corrected form, it just copies the Bible. It resembles the Bible very closely. In fact, the Etruscans flourished just centuries ago. The cross is present in their artwork, the Christian cross. They knew very well about Christ. And the mainstream historians are telling us that they are working hard on solving this mystery of why the Etruscan book resembles, the main Etruscan book resembles the Bible so closely. They are working so hard, and surprise, surprise, there is no explanation yet. It is still a mystery. And by the way, the very name of that main book of theirs can tell us quite a lot. It is called Sudnaya Kniga. And again, I don't know any ancient European languages, and yet I understand this just because I know Slavic languages. It means simply Book of Law. Very strange. They have even made up a proverb saying Etruscan unreadable in Italian. to really convince people, and they always underline with such bold letters that Etruscan is absolutely unreadable and will never be readable, and it is a mystery and all that. And yet millions of people who know Slavic languages can understand without any translation. Interesting, is this just another African, or is some other chap of the blue ones? There in Egypt, the blue ones, also in India, Krishna belonged to the blue race. So we must have had some blue ones around everywhere. So to summarize, the Etruscans are just an excellent example of how unnecessary mystification is used to cover up the real history and cover up the biggest of all mysteries, which is how descendants of magicians like ourselves have been tricked into believing to be descendants of apes.